Good evening. I'd like to thank you all for coming tonight, especially some of my closest friends and family I have here tonight. Today I'm going to be talking about my experience as a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in Australia. To make a long story short, I was basically born and raised in a church, and I have four brothers that are members of the church also. Three of them went on missions. So being an Australian Mormon is a bit different than being a Mormon in the United States. And so this is my testimony as being a member of the church outside of the United States. Growing up, my mother and father were Methodists, and the missionaries came to the door of my home when I was around 3 months old. The missionaries had taught the gospel to my mother. She accepted and got baptized, but my father never did. Three of my brothers went on missions. I didn't. I was a bit of a black sheep before I went to the temple and got married and sealed in the temple. I also worked in the temple full time. I was actually receiving a salary at the time because I was working in the kitchen. While I was in the church, growing up, about 50% of the wards that I was growing up in the church, the chapels that I was raised up in, were full of Polynesian members of the church. That included Maori, Samoans and Tongans, Cook Islands and so forth. And I developed a very close relationship with those people. While being raised up with the Maori culture in the church, there was a big emphasis on what they call Lamanites. Now, I was growing up in the period of Spencer W. Kimball's in the 70s and 80s, where there was a group called the Lamanite Generation. The Lamanite Generation was a mixture of Polynesian, Hawaiian, and Incas, the Peru, all the way up to North American, Native American Indians. And they did a big performance. There was a show where they sung different songs and did their tribal dance or folkloric dances and stuff. And it was a really wonderful thing. And it did boost the morale, if you will, of the indigenous and Maoris in particular, that they were, that they were identified as a special people. And so as Gentiles like myself, we always raised them up as the Lamanites, and that God had blessed us through the Lamanites, giving us the Book of Mormon. So that was the concept I was raised up on, and that the Lamanites were special people and so forth. In the whole Lamanite period, when it was promoting heavily about Lamanites are the house of Israel, the descendants of the Jews, and that a certain group of Lamanites had migrated from North America and went into Hawaii and then into the Polynesian Islands. I was raised up to believe that these people not only were descendants of Nephi and Lehi and Laman and Lemuel, but that they were also a covenant-keeping people, that God had a promise, a special promise for them. And so it was always this feeling that, this kinship. Now, this part's important to explain, because being an Australian and being a Mormon was not as easy as what you might think. It's not like being a Mormon in the US, it's the whole, Mormon has spread right through America. Being a Mormon in Australia back in when I was a youth, you felt quite intimidated, and you didn't go around telling them, hey, I'm a Mormon. You basically lived a life as a closet Mormon, basically. And so when people found out you were a Mormon, it was sort of like, you get bullied around and pushed around and all the rest of it. And so I made friends with some really big Maoris, and I mean, they were, you know, over 6 foot, real big guys. And so I always felt like, there was a movie at that time, it was called Revenge of the Nerds, and I always felt some kind of, you know, feeling like just like those nerds that had the African-American fraternity that looked after them from the jocks and the bullies at school. So I felt the same with the Maoris, the Lamanites. You felt this special power with women, the stripling soldiers, as we would call them, you know. So anyway, there was this close kinship I had with them in more than just one way, because in Australian culture, we're a very closed culture. We're very independent, and, you know, when the joey grows too big for the kangaroo's pouch, it jumps out, doesn't go back in. It's the same sort of concept. Once you get to a certain age, you know, you move on, you go walk about, whatever you want to do. You go on a tour for 7 years around the world because we're so far away from everyone else. So, you know, you just go on these walk about trails. So that's what it was like, you know. You're very, what you would call cold. You know, you could live next door to a neighbour and not know their name for over 20 years, you know. I mean, it was pretty crazy. But in the Maori community, in the church, it was different. They were really into the extended family. So I really loved that atmosphere of the extended family. And I tried all my best to try to participate in being involved in church activities, and they would invite me to their homes and made me feel like I was one of them, you know. As they say in Spanish, mi casa es tu casa, in English, you know, my house is your house. Fridge open, everything open, you just walk through and, you know, help yourself. Not the same with the Australians, though. We're pretty tight ship when it comes to making friends like that, especially even with extended family concepts, you know. We might visit our mum in Christmas or in Easter, but most of the time, you know, because Australia's so big, you know, parents could be on one side of the, you know, 3 days away from you or whatever, you know. So that's the way it is in our culture. But so there was things I really loved about the Polynesians, and the whole concept of the Book of Mormon pulling me into that idea that, hey, these are the special people, these are the descendants of the House of Israel, they're Lamanites. And it was a really powerful, beautiful period, and I really admired that period, and you know. But then after Spencer W. Kimball died, there was a massive change, a massive turnaround that was going on in the church. It was a turmoil. And I mean, regarding the word Lamanite was becoming a dirty word, you know, you don't identify people anymore, no one's special, we're all the same, we're all a bunch of Gentiles, become a House of Israel. So I'm a white guy, so I'm from Ephraim, if you're dark skinned, you're from Manasseh. This was the concept. And so while there was these two ideas pushing at each other, because it was still the, you know, those that wanted to believe in the old school concept of, you know, the Lamanites or the special people, this new modernizing concept that was moving into the church, that no, we're not like that anymore. So what happened at that period, a general authority of the church, his name was George P. Lee, he was a Navajo Indian, actually spoke up about it, and he wrote two letters to the church officials. At that time it was Ezra Taft Benson, and Ezra Taft Benson was old school. He believed that intermixing cultures was a sign of communism, and that needed to stop that concept. They decided to stop the whole Lamanite generation, and that was a very sad thing. But this particular general authority, who was Navajo Indian, who was basically raised under the help of Spencer W. Kimball, who obviously thought that this guy could maybe one day lead the church. So he was complaining that the church had started withdrawing all their aid, that the help, that there was the support, there was many programs going on in the Navajo reservation, they're pulling them all out. And saying, well, they're just like everybody else, you can't have. But, you know, for the Navajo Indian, they're a very, it's extreme poverty. I wouldn't call it a third world country. It's because they say it's a nation within a nation because they've got their own constitution. That's why now they've got casinos and prostitutes everywhere selling tobacco. But the point is that in their actual reservation, I would call it a fourth world country, like Madagascar. The people are incredibly poor, and it was a terrible, terrible sight to see. That these were the neighbours of the Mormons in Utah, and there's extreme poverty just over the border of Utah into Arizona, what they call Monument Valley. Even Bluff and Blanding in the Four Corners area, all of that, it's just a hideous sight to see the way the poor Native American Indians have been treated. Downtrodden for so many years, it's just disgusting. But anyway, my point is that this particular gentleman was raised up in a program called the Indian Placement Program, which was very similar to that movie, that famous movie called Rapid Proof Fence in Australia, when they would kidnap the little children, the Aboriginal children, and put them into these institutions and through the Salvation Army or whatever, and force them not to speak their dialect. They had to, you know, become an Aussie, you know, Great Australian Dream, like the American Dream, whatever that is. But so, you know, we had to whitewash the Aborigines so they would become like us. And unfortunately, by the age of 18, a lot of them were suicidal. They hit the alcohol and the rest of it. And so the police got into the brutality of beating up these Aboriginals and the rest of it. Same thing happened to Maoris in New Zealand. In fact, there's a movie, it's called Once Were Warriors, terribly sad story, you know, about the Maori culture. The degeneracy caused by alcoholism, because there's so much racism, there's a white supremacy, and then there's the indigenous, you know. And there's no real support structure anymore lifting up these people and giving them the welfare to make them great again. Instead, it's more like an envy or a jealousy to keep them down. And so I noticed that with the Aboriginals, and I noticed it with the Maoris. So when I went to the United States, it was in 1995, I went to the US, but in 96, Dallin H. Oaks had a special anniversary. It was the 25th, I think from memory, it was the 25th anniversary of the Lamanite generation in Provo. The Brigham Young University was holding this special event where they were going to have this anniversary. Well, you know, there was all sorts of groups of Maoris there and different islanders and you know, from Samoa, Tonga, all the rest of it. And there was also a group of people from the Hopi and the Navajo Reservation. Now, if you can imagine, you've got Dylan H. Oaks speaking to all these groups of people, and in the middle of his conversation he says, well, we're going to stop the Lamanite generation. We're no longer going to have this anymore. You people are no different than anybody else. We're all the same now. We're all going to be put into this mountain. Basically, there's no distinction between a Gentile and a Lamanite. We're all the same. So in 95, this message was very strong. Now, it seemed to me like it was a rebuttal, if you will, to try to get people to forget their legacy that were Maoris or Lamanites because of whatever occurred with the Navajo Indian. His name was George P. Lee. It was obvious that the church feared that if the Lamanite generation kept growing, that they would promote this idea that, hey, we're special and you are the Gentiles and all the rest of it. So it was then that the seeds were really being planted and implemented in the church that, you know, you're all just the same. However, by withdrawing all these welfare programs and these special things that they had going, they also refused to give them higher callings, didn't want any more trouble with American Indians, obviously. So, one of the things that woke me up a lot was in there, in the Book of Mormon, it says in Mormon chapter 8, verses 15 to 22, and I'll quote what it says. It says, For none can have power to bring it to light, talking about the Book of Mormon. No one has the power to bring the Book of Mormon to light, save it is given him of God. For God wills that it shall be done with an eye single to his glory, all the welfare of the ancient and long dispersed covenant people of the Lord, which are the Lamanites. Supposedly, if we care about the welfare of these guys as Gentiles, and we lift them up on our shoulders and be nursing mothers and fathers, that's what the Book of Mormon says, that we will raise them up on our shoulders and we'll do all this nursing on them. If we do that and we care about their welfare, then we can bring to light the Book of Mormon. And then it says in verse 21, this is very important, it says, and he that shall breathe out wrath and strifes against the work of the Lord and against the covenant people of the Lord who are of the house of Israel, and shall say, we will destroy the work of the Lord, and the Lord will not remember his covenant which he has made unto the house of Israel, the same is in danger to be honed down and cast into the fire. For the eternal purposes of the Lord shall roll on until all the promises shall be fulfilled. Whoa! Now, for a Mormon watching me say this right now, you're going to say, oh, that's talking about you. It's talking about me, because you're saying, oh, what are you doing? You're taking the church, you haven't had me in the church in all this. No. If you read it properly, it's very, very clear in this verse. It says, talking about against the covenant people of the Lord who are the house of Israel. Oh, yeah, but we're all the house of Israel. We come from Ephraim. Actually, we're Gentiles. And the house of Israel were meant to be the Maoris, the Native American Indians, and all the indigenous in the Americas. They're meant to be the lost 10 tribes of Israel, right? That's what I was programmed to believe. There was a distinction between us and them, and that we were blessed being descendants of Ephraim, but being the Gentiles, as it keeps saying, the Gentiles will be given the gospel, the Gentiles will raise up the house of Israel, the remnant of Jacob, and all the rest of it. So there's always an identity between the remnant of Jacob, the house of Israel, the lost 10 tribes of Israel, and the Gentiles. And the church of the Gentiles, which was the book was given to them, they then go and give to the house of Israel. Very, very clear. The identity of the two groups is black and white. But here, the part I really want to emphasize is when it says, we will destroy the work of the Lord, and the Lord will not remember his covenant which he hath made unto the house of Israel. The same is in danger to be honed down and cast in the fire. So, there is this promise in the Book of Mormon that was emphasized that the Lamanites, God will remember his covenant. He will return the lands, their inheritances. You know, after the Gentiles have scattered them and made them drunk and crack cocaine and all the rest of it, then God will remember them and restore them and bring them back to their lands, and they're going to build the new Jerusalem and build this great temple. This is the whole concept. However, that's all being wiped clean. Because we're not meant to think that the Lamanites are going to come and rescue the Gentiles, us, from the secret combinations of the American government. Now what we're saying is that we're all the house of Israel. There's no distinction. Once you get baptized as a member of the Mormon Church, you're now of the tribe of Ephraim or of the tribe of Manasseh, according to the color of skin. Now, here I have a statement. This is from an interview in January 29th, 2002. It was conducted by a reporter, Helmick, I can't even pronounce his name, it's German, Nemesek, whatever that is. And it was on the channel ZDF Television Germany at Salt Lake City, Utah, in the Church Administration Building. Okay, so this German reporter comes and asks some questions to Gordon B. Hinckley, the prophet of the Mormon Church, after Ezra Taft Benson and Hal Hunter died. Okay, so this is a question. The reporter says, now, Mr. President, talking to Gordon B. Hinckley, one question which is a little bit complicated for me to understand, but I heard it, and one colleague asked me to ask you, what will be your position when DNA analysis will show that in history there never had been an immigration from Israel to North America. It could be that scientists will find out. Wow. So Gordon B. Hinckley's response to that DNA question, dum, 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 he says, it hasn't happened, that hasn't been determined yet, because back then they still hadn't got the actual results of the DNA to prove whether the Lamanites were descendants of the House of Israel or not. But still, you know, we've got this idea that, hey, you know, it's left out in the open right now. It hasn't happened, that hasn't been determined yet. All I can say, this is from the prophet seer revelator, who knows of the things that were, who knows the things that are, and who knows the things that are coming, according to the Book of Mormon. That's what a seer's job is. He can know of the hidden things and all sorts of things, so, you know. And it says that for the people, the seer is a pretty important person. A seer, revelator, and prophet. It's not just a prophet. This guy, he can foretell the future. He can see when somebody has done a murder. He's able to foretell the murder and tell the authorities, hey, hang on, look at him. Still waiting for finding out the truth about JFK, who really shot JFK. Anyway, it hasn't happened. That hasn't been determined yet. All I can say is that no one really knows that the answer to that, not at this point. Okay, so that was an interview that was done in January 29, 2002, conducted by reporter Howard, whatever his name is, and that was in the church administration, to the prophet, seer, and revelator. He says, and I'll quote again, it hasn't happened. This is talking about the DNA results, to find out if the Lamanites are Jews or not. He says, it hasn't happened yet, okay? That hasn't been determined yet. All I can say is that it's speculative. No one really knows that, the answer to that, not at this point. Now, number one, he's meant to be a prophet, seer, and revelator. Thus saith the Lord. You know, what happened to the thus saith the Lord? You see it through canonized version of the Doctrine and Covenants, Joseph Smith, everywhere he went, thus saith the Lord, this, thus saith the Lord, that. And now suddenly we're not saying thus saith the Lord. We're going to wait for the scientists to tell us if the Lamanites are Jews or not, or if they're descendants of the House of Israel. Okay. Number one, so we can get things really straight here. How I understand, Lehi was of the tribe of Manasseh. Now, Manasseh has nothing to do with Judah. In fact, in the 12 brothers, Joseph was sent out into Egypt, and the Pharaoh gave Joseph some goddess, servant of the Egyptian wife, for Joseph to marry. So Joseph's marrying not only not one of his own people, but he's marrying some pagan from Egypt, and this pagan from Egypt has the two sons called Ephraim and Manasseh. Okay. Now, another good thing to note here is that Judah's mum and Joseph's mum were two different mothers, right? And the sons of Manasseh, the son of Manasseh, and the son of Judah have two different fathers with two different mothers. You see, so straight away you're going to get a complete breakdown of completely different people. Now, were the Egyptian goddesses a bit Asian, bit Native African, you know, Ethiopian? We don't really fully know. Some say the Phoenicians came from Ethiopia, some say they're Asian. Who knows? But my point is, they were definitely not the family of Jacob. So we can clearly see the DNA is going to be different. That is so. So if we're going to make a marker and compare the DNA here to a white European Jew and compare it to a Polynesian, you know, you're going to go in total tangents here, because, you know, according to the promise of Abraham, his seed is more than the sands of the sea. You know, he's going to have a multitude of seed all around the world. It's going to be amazing. And to be totally honest, the Jews themselves don't really seem to populate that many people. But we do know that if there is the lost 10 tribes of Israel and they spread all over the place, then there's seeds everywhere, the seed of Abraham. And, you know, I just think that we seem to forget that, that there is more than just Judah in the house of Israel. So comparing to, like I say, a lot of people are claiming now that the Jews in Europe are not really Jews anyway. They just claim to be Jews so they can get all the benefits of going to Israel. Ooh, sorry, I shouldn't say that. That's anti-Semitic. But just to be on the safe side, there was a migration of Jews in Kazakhstan and we're borrowed from in those places in, around Russia and Ukraine and all that, who claim it was convenient to claim to be a Jew at a certain period of time. So when that migration went into Europe, there's also those Jews. And, you know, that's a different story. But my point is that to actually identify a real Jew is hard, because in Revelations it says they claim they are Jews, but they're not of the synagogue of Satan. So, you know, there are certain individuals who claim to be Jews and building up these synagogues, but the synagogues of Satan, and they're not Jews at all. They're lying. That's in the book of Revelations. That's by John the Revelator. That's not just me pretending or making this up. So anyway, my point is that from this little comment here that Gordon Hinckley, the prophet, seer, revelator, who doesn't really know if the Lamanites at this time are actually descendants of the house of Israel, and then he goes on to say they're going to wait for the results before they'll make up their mind either which way. That shouldn't have been an issue. If he was a true prophet, seer, and revelator, he's not going to wait till a scientist tell him, insist that the land is flat. You know, or wait until Christopher Columbus comes over to the other side of the world and says, no, it's round. You know, we're not here to believe that we evolved from monkeys. The whole Darwin theory was science-based, the whole theory on the, you know, evolution rather than creation. I always thought there was a distinction between the spiritual connection of God and how he did things and how scientists are trying to claim it the form of man. So getting back to what I'm saying here, Gordon B. Hinckley is not identifying, even though the Book of Mormon for all these many years have said, and we've been taught, that the Lamanites are the descendants of the house of Israel, and that the Book of Mormon was written for the Native American Indians, which also meant all the Americas from Canada all the way down the north, and all the Polynesians as well. This is no longer an emphasis at all. And Gordon B. Hinckley doesn't really have an interest to push that concept either. In fact, the church has sort of modified the Book of Mormon introduction to not emphasize that anymore, which seems absolutely ludicrous, this dramatic transformation in such a short time. And what was it all about? I mean, logically, if we based our faith on what people say, then, you know, we don't really have a faith. You know, why do we want to win the crowd support? I thought it was always being a peculiar people and being different anyway. You know, we're a royal priesthood and all the rest of that concept. You know, we're meant to be different. So who cares if we get persecuted? Who cares if they say, you know, you think the Lamanites are special? Who cares? I think the idea was is to be grateful to the Lamanites for giving us the Book of Mormon. You know, their descendants, their forefathers gave to us. That's what I thought. But as I said, as the scripture in Mormon chapter 8 said very clearly, talking about that God's will be done with an eye single to his glory, all the welfare of his ancient, long dispersed covenant people. And he that wills shall speak out wrath and strife against the work of the Lord and against the covenant people of the Lord, who are the house of Israel, and shall say, we will destroy the work of the Lord, and the Lord will not remember his covenant which he hath made unto the house of Israel. And that's, to me, what Gordon B. Hinckley is doing here. He is destroying the work of the Lord, that the Lord will not remember his covenant to the Lamanites. Remember that, because after all, he says, No one really knows that answer to that, not at this point, because the scientists hadn't came back with the DNA. That was back in 2002. But then when the DNA was revealed that the Lamanites were supposedly not Jews, okay, so the church went the way the world told them to go. And that was, okay, we'll eradicate that. There was only a very small little amount of Jews, and they've all been gone extinct now. So what we have is just mestizos, you know, mixed Spanish and Latin Americans and a bunch of Indians that were Asian descent. But the truth is, if you know, in my case, you know, I'm married to a Latin American, and the culture is not Asian whatsoever. It's very, very different. And the other thing is that the culture also emphasizes a lot of traditions that did come out of the Bible, even when it was in the wicked time when they were Egyptian, are influenced. The Latin culture seems to be very, you know, whether it's the Guadalupe idol or whatever, you know, a lot of them get into the witchcraft and all the rest of it. It's not an Asian thing to do. But it was a House of Israel thing to put up these monuments and all these idols and you know, have all this superstitious, you know, things going on. So, I mean, and plus there are different things also that indicate that before George Washington, William Penn wrote a thesis about the Native American Indians William Penn was actually, the name of Pennsylvania was named after this man, who was a Quaker. And he did a whole thesis on the subject that the American Indians were actually the descendants of the House of Israel because all their cultural, the way they do the Feast of Tabernacles and all these different rituals that the Indians were doing were very similar to the feasts and so forth of the Jews. And so even the way they dress, the way they eat, they called, they kept referring to the Great Spirit, and they said they had their Ten Commandments and all sorts of strange things, which had nothing to do with Asia whatsoever, but had much more inclined to do with the concept of lost 10 tribes of Israel. Anyway, that is what I was told and raised up to believe.